الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. Dear respected brothers and sisters, because of the fact that many of the brothers and sisters, they have the commentary and the explanation of الأصول الثلاث by الشيخ العلامة الشيخ محمد بن صالح العثيمين رحمه الله. So that's why the administration of مسجد عمر بن الخطاب they have switched to the explanation of الشيخ العلامة محمد بن صالح العثيمين رحمه الله. So those who have the book or they have the PDF, we will be starting, inshallah ta'ala, from the explanation of the Shaykh. Not from the text, but from the explanation of a Shaykh, Muhammad bin Salih al-Uthaymeen, rahimahullah ta'ala. So now, the beginning, the Shaykh, Shaykh al-Islam, Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, he started out with al-Basmala, in the name of Allah. Now the Shaykh bin Uthaymeen is going to explain al-Basmala to us. So he said, the author, may Allah have mercy upon him, begins his book with al-Basmala. Al-Basmala is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This is al-Basmala. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, the best bestower of mercy. And the scholars, they said, Ar-Rahman, whose mercy encompasses all of his creation. So this applies to believers and non-believers. This applies to plants and animals and other creation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. So basically you can say, this is a general mercy. This is a general mercy. So Ar-Rahman, whose mercy encompasses all of his creation. Ar-Rahim, al-Ulama, they mention, including our Shaykh al-Allama, Shaykh Abdul Aziz bin Ibaz, rahimahullah, that Ar-Rahim is exclusively for the believers. وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever merciful towards the believers. So that's the meaning of Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. The Shaykh said, following the example set by the Book of Allah, the Mighty and Majestic, which begins with it. Because when you look at the Quran, you find out that the Quran starts out with al-Basmala, except one surah, Surah Bara'a. Other than that, every surah that you read starts out with al-Basmala. And the most correct opinion of the among the scholars is al-Basmala is not part of the surah. It's not part of the surah. Like for example, Surah Al-Fatiha starts out with Al-Basmala. And Al-Basmala is not part of the surah. Reason being, because of Al-Hadith Al-Qudsi. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I have divided the salat between me and my servant. So when my servant says, Alhamdulillah, Ya Rabbil Alameen, and Allah responds to him or her, and he says, my servant has praised me. And he did not say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Shows you right there that al-Basmala is not part of the surah. طيب. The Shaykh, he said also, and also in accordance with the hadith. So this hadith is weak, very, very weak. But the Shaykh, he mentioned it, very important for us to know this hadith, that it is not an authentic hadith. every important matter which is not begun with Basmala is deprived of good. This hadith is declared da'if, jiddan, very weak, by Sheikh Al-Albani in his book Al-Irwa Al-Ghalib. So this hadith is weak. So if you hear someone saying, quoting this hadith, then you know this hadith is weak. It is also in accordance with the way of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, since he used to begin his letters with it. This is authentic, because the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he used to send letters, he would start with Al-Basmala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This sentence means Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim has an unspoken part. So there is something missing there. There's something missing. Essential to the completion of the meaning. And its full meaning is, in the name of Allah I write. So when you say Bismillah and you want to eat, automatically you know that Bismillah I start eating, right? So when you want to write, same thing, you say Bismillah. So even though you don't say it, but it is implied. It is implied. And this is known in the Quran. The Shaykh said, Rahimahullah Ta'ala, he said, in this case, since verbs are necessary for actions, and we understand that it is to come after in the name of Allah and not before it, because the action starts before al-basmala, when you want to eat, you're going to start eating, begin, and then you say Bismillah, say Bismillah, and the action, of course, precedes. So it is necessary for action. And we understand that it is to come after in the name of Allah and not before it, due to 2 points. First, to seek blessing by beginning with the name of Allah. Because when you start with the name of Allah and you eat, then Allah will put blessing in your food, even though the food might not be sufficient for 2 people or 3 people, Allah will put barakah in it, blessing, and it will be enough, bi-idhnillah. طيب. So that's the first point, to seek blessing by beginning with the name of Allah, the one free of all imperfection and the most high. Second, that this is a way of expressing the fact that it is the only cause for writing. So by taking this sentence to be what is meant, we find that it makes false sense, as opposed to the case, for example, if we were to about to read a book, just said, in the name of Allah I begin, since what you are starting would be clear, but in the name of Allah I begin to read leaves no room for doubt. See? So in the first case, you leave it open. It's not clear. Second case, it's very clear. So what we have understood, the unspoken word to be makes full and complete sentence. So now the sentence is completed. Second, Allah. Now the Shaykh is going to define what does Allah mean. So the Shaykh, he said, it is the title of the sole Lord who created and fashioned everything. He, the majestic and the most high, this is the name of his, which all of his other names follow on from. So this is the main name of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, as occurs in his statement, Alif Lam Ra. This is a book which sent which we sent down to you in order that you might lead mankind out of darkness into light by the permission of their Lord, to the path of Almighty, the one worthy of all praise, Allah, to whom belongs everything that is in the heavens and the earth, the most merciful, the bestower of mercy. The Sheikh, he said, the most merciful, Rahman, is one of the names which are particular to Allah, mighty and majestic, and cannot be applied to other than Him. So meaning someone cannot call himself Ar-Rahman or Ar-Rahim. This is not permissible, because this is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahman means the one who has as his attribute very great and extensive mercy. Ar-Rahim, the bestower of mercy, is a name which is applied to Allah, the mighty and majestic, and the term may be restrictly applied to others also. Its meaning is one who is merciful to others. Ar-Rahman is the one who possesses very great and extensive mercy. Ar-Rahim, the one who has mercy upon whomever he wishes from his servant. As Allah the Most High says, He justly punished whomever He wills, is disobedient, and shows mercy to whomever He wills, to Him you will be returned. طيب. After this, the Imam Rahimahullah, Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, he will start with I'lam Rahimakallah. Know, may Allah have mercy on you. طيب. Sheikh Al-Uthaymeen Rahimahullah, he said, العلم, knowledge, is to comprehend the reality of something as it truly is, with certainty. طيب. I will give you an example. Now, you are sitting in the masjid. So when you say, I am sitting in the masjid, this is knowledge. This is knowledge. Because you comprehend this reality, طيب, that this is a masjid, as it truly is. Nobody can come and say, this is not a masjid. Because you have certainty that it is. When someone asks you, what is the meaning of La ilaha illallah? And you say, La ilaha illallah means there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. This is knowledge. Because no one has doubt about it. Everyone agrees, this is the meaning of La ilaha illallah. If someone says something opposite to that, then this person is speaking without knowledge. Ayyib. And the Sheikh said the level of comprehension are six. So what he wants to tell you, that when it comes to al-idraq, comprehension, there are six levels. And this is very important to know. And these six levels of comprehension are studied in usul al-fiqh, the principle of jurisprudence. The principle of jurisprudence. Very important for students of knowledge to know these six levels. The Sheikh, he said, first knowledge, al-ilm, which is to comprehend the reality of something as it truly is, with certainty. When you ask someone about the two pillars of La ilaha illallah, he says, النفي والإدراك. النفي والإثبات. النفي والإثبات. Negation and affirmation. And he gives you an example. La ilaha illallah has both. The first part of it is negation. Second part of it is affirmation. This is knowledge. Because this person has comprehended the reality, La ilaha illallah, as it truly is with certainty. This is called al-ilm. وهو إدراك الشيء على ما هو عليه إدراكا جازما. The second level, slight ignorance, الجهل البسيط. الجهل البسيط. Which is absence of full comprehension. For example, you ask someone about the conditions of La ilaha illallah. And he says, I don't know. Can you teach me? This person has slight ignorance because he doesn't have knowledge. So it is the absence of full comprehension. He doesn't know. And there's nothing wrong with someone saying, I don't know, if you don't know. That's actually knowledge, ulama, they say. That's actually knowledge when you say, I don't know. Ask someone who has knowledge. طيب. Number three, aggravated, compounded ignorance, الجهل المركب. Which is to comprehend something in a way contrary to its true reality. وبالمثال يتضح المقال. With the statement and the example, with the example, the statement becomes clear. So I'll give you an example. You ask someone, what are the conditions of La ilaha illallah? He says, you have to be a Muslim. You have to be sane. You have to have wudu until the 9 conditions of salat. So this person has compounded ignorance. Why? Because he understood this reality, which is the conditions of La ilaha illallah, on the contrary to its true reality. So he understood it on the contrary of its true reality. You tell him the sky is blue, he says no. The sky is gray. Hey, akhi, sky is gray. Look at it. And he argues. And he says, the sky is gray. So this person has what? Aggravated, compounded ignorance. Because he comprehends his comprehension of something, which is the sky being blue, in a way contrary to its reality. You say, this is water? He said, no, this is oil. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from compounded ignorance. Then the sheikh, he said, number 5, delusion, al-wahm. In Arabic, they call it, Number five, delusion. So he said, rahimahullah ta'ala, number four, delusion, al-wahm, which is to think that one comprehends something despite the presence of that which should cause you to realize that you are incorrect. For example, Muhammad was standing at the door of the masjid. And I saw him, and I know that is Muhammad. So this is the first category, which is knowledge, which is to comprehend the reality of something as it truly is, with certainty. طيب. Now somebody comes in, and I said to him, did you see Muhammad at the gate? He said, no, that's not Muhammad. That is Ahmed. I believe that is Ahmed. This is called wahm. This is called delusion. Because this person, he was deluded. He thought the person he saw at the door is Ahmed, not Muhammad. طيب. So this is called delusion. And many times ulama al-hadith, they use this. And they said, wahima al-sheikh fulan. Scholar so-and-so, he got deluded. Right, because sometimes certain narrators, they carry the same name and they carry also the tribe name or the last name. And one of them is good and the other one is not in hadith. So the scholar, he makes a mistake, scholar of hadith. And he mentioned the weak one. And the scholars, they will say that this scholar got deluded because he thought this is the one who is good in hadith and the reality is not. That's called al-wahm. Then number 5, ash-shakk, doubt. Ash-shakk, which is to think that you comprehend something, yet you are aware of something contrary to it, which you think has the same possibility of being the truth. We go back to Muhammad. You ask another person, and you say to him, have you seen Muhammad at the door? He said, that person is either Muhammad or Ahmed. So he is what? Doubtful. This is called doubt. Shak. طيب. Now, number 6. Preponderant belief. Preponderant belief. Most likely to be correct. For example, another person comes in. And I said, did you see Muhammad at the entrance of the masjid? And he said, yes, most likely and most probably that is Muhammad who is standing at the door. This is called الظن, الظن الراجح, preponderant opinion, preponderant belief. And the ulama, they use it in al-fatawa, that they will look at all the evidence and they will say that the most preponderant opinion is this. The madhab of Imam Abu Hanifa, or the madhab of Imam Malik, or the madhab of Shafi'i, or the madhab of Imam Ahmad, or even the madhab of Sufyan ibn Sa'id al-Thawri, or al-Awza'i, or any of the scholars. So this is the preponderant belief, which is comprehension of something despite the presence of something which is contrary to it, but which is less likely to be true. So basically, the preponderant belief is the most likely to be true, while the opposite is not. طيب. Then after the Sheikh, he explained the 3 levels of knowledge. Now he's going to divide knowledge into 2 categories. It's very important for the student of knowledge. He said, knowledge, al-ilm, is of 2 categories. طيب. Inevitable, daruri. They call it daruri. Inevitable, daruri. It is known by necessity. For example, Allah is our Lord. This is ilm, daruri. This is knowledge that is known by necessity. All Muslims will agree. There's nobody who will disagree that Allah is our Lord. Everyone will agree that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our Lord. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is our messenger. This is ilm daruri. Ilm daruri, inevitable knowledge. Or if you wish, you can say, knowledge known by necessity. Knowledge known by necessity. Likewise, the 5 daily prayers. This is ilm that is known by necessity. طيب. And speculative nadari. Nadari, inevitable knowledge that requires investigation. طيب. That requires investigation. So inevitable knowledge is that which is known inviolably without any need to investigate the first category or prove with the evidence. Everybody knows those matters. For example, the fact that the fire is hot. This is known to everyone by physical evidence. If you put your hand, you're going to get burnt. So everyone knows this for a fact. Whereas speculative knowledge is that which requires investigation and proofs. For example, the knowledge that it is obligatory to have intention when making ablution. So this one we have to look, investigate the ayat, the hadith, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And indeed, yes, one of the conditions of al-wudu is a niyyah. And Sheikh Abdul Rahman bin Nasr al-Sa'di rahimahullah, he said, وَالنِّيَّةُ شَرْطٌ لِسَائِرِ الْعَمَلِ بِهَا الصَّلَاحُ وَالْفَسَادُ لِلْعَمَلِ. Sheikh Abdul Rahman al-Sa'di rahimahullah, he said, and the intention is a condition for all deeds and action to be accepted or to be rejected. So the intention is a judge for all the actions, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, innama al-a'malu bin-niyyat wa innama likulli imri'in ma nawa. Actions are based on their intention, and for each person what he intended. And we give you some example. Sheikh al-Allama al-Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he said, if a man performs the wudu to cool off because the weather is hot, so he went and he performed the wudu with cold water with the intention to cool off. Now a niyya, this niyya of this man or this woman, is not, it did not stem from an act of worship. It did not stem from an act of worship. So this niyya will not be valid when it comes to the ibadah. So it means that this person cannot perform the salat with this wudu, because his niyyah was not, did not stem from an act of worship. It's for personal benefit. Likewise, al-Shaykh al-Allama Salih bin Fawzan al-Fawzan, bidahullah, he said, if a man makes ghusl with the intention to clean himself up, he said, this ghusl will not be valid for salat. And this person has not lifted yet that state of being sexually defiled, means from al-janaba. So he has not lifted that state of janaba yet. Why? Because of the intention. And Sheikh al-Allama al-Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he was asked a question about a man who was determined to break his fast. His niyyah was determined to break his fast, but he did not break his fast. What is the rule? The Sheikh, he said, his fast is broken. His fast is broken because the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, innama al-a'malu bin-niyyat wa innama likulli imri'in ma nawa. Actions are based on their intention, and for each person what he intended. And the ulama, they said that the intention has different benefits. One of them, it distinguishes between an act of worship and an act of habit, like the examples I gave from the scholars, the examples of al-wudu, Sheikh al-Uthaymeen, and al-ghusl, Sheikh Salih bin Fawzan al-Fawzan, the one who broke his fast, even though he did not eat, because his intention was to break it, even though he did not eat. He did not eat anything, but he broke it because he was determined to break his fast. So this is the first benefit. Distinguishes the, between that which is an act of ibadah and that which is an act of habit. I'll give an example. A man and his wife, they're having dinner together. One of them is having the intention to strengthen their body so that they can worship Allah, so that they can make Qiyam al-Layl, so that they can wake up early morning for Salat al-Fajr and pray, so that they can recite the Quran, so that they can fast. Then he or she will be rewarded for eating dinner. Even though al-asl, the origin, dinner, eating dinner is something permissible. Halal. Al-mubah. Alhamdulillah. Permissible. Drinking water is permissible. But because the intention behind it changes the whole scenario. You see the importance of al-niyya. And also al-ulama, they mention that al-niyya distinguishes between that which is done for the sake of Allah and that which is not done for the sake of Allah. For example, a man gives $1 for the sake of Allah and he intends to please Allah. And he doesn't have much, so he gives $1. Another man, he gives $1 million, but he wants his name to be heard. He wants the people to praise him and the like. So he's showing off. Then the first one, he will be rewarded. And the second one will not be rewarded. As a matter of fact, this person is sinning. And it's a dangerous affair. The other benefit when it comes to the intention, al-ulama mentioned that it distinguishes between different type of ibadat. For example, when you perform the salat, the intention is not like when you give the zakat. And when you give the zakat, it's the same as fasting the month of Ramadan. They're not the same. What about fasting the month of Ramadan and performing Hajj? The intention is going to shift. You see? And also, al-ulama, they mention that the intention also differentiate between the same ibadat. For example, Salat al-Fajr. You have the sunnah and you have the obligatory. You pray the sunnah before and the obligatory prayer after. What differentiates between them? The intention. Also, ikhwan, brothers and sisters, this is very important for tulab al-ilm, for the student of knowledge. And al-ulama, they mention, can you combine two intentions in one? For example, someone, he was in a state of janab, so he had to make ghusl on the day of Jumu'ah. But he also wants to make a ghusl for Jumu'ah. Can he suffice with one intention for both of them? Yes, he can. And this is the opinion of the majority of the ulama, Sheikh Muhammad bin Ibrahim al-Sheikh, rahimahullah, Sheikh al-Allama عبد الرحمن بن ناصر السعدي, الشيخ بن باز, الشيخ العثيمين, and others. Even though الشيخ الألباني, الله, he has a different opinion. He said you have to make two ghusl. But والله أعلم, the opinion of the majority is more correct. Because one ghusl with the intention of lifting that state of major impurity and ghusl for Jumu'ah will be sufficient. This is some of the benefit about the importance of al-niyyah, the intention. The Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, rahimakallah. So the Shaykh Islam Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, he's making dua for the reader, the one who will read his three ties, rahimakallah. May Allah shower his mercy upon you, such as will enable you to reach reach what you seek and escape what you fear. So full meaning is, may Allah forgive your previous sins and guide you to what is good, correct in future, and protect you from sins in future. This is the case if the term rahmah, mercy, is used on its own. If, however, the term maghfirah, forgiveness, is used alone with it, then maghfirah means forgiveness of one's previous sins, whereas rahmah, mercy, will refer to the granting of what is good and protecting from sins in the future. So the words, the author, rahimahullah, show the care, the concern, which he has for the reader, and that he intends and desires good for him, rahimahullah ta'ala. This is from the care of the Shaykh, rahmatullahi alayhi, Shaykh al-Islam, Muhammad ibn Abd al-Wahhab, rahimahullah ta'ala. Then he said that it is obligatory upon you to have knowledge of four matters. Now, Shaykh al-Islam, after he started with an introduction, then he went into the subject matter of this risala, these three times. So he said that it is obligatory upon you to have knowledge of four matters. It is obligatory, means that you have to have knowledge. You have to have knowledge of them. Nah. Knowledge, which is knowledge and awareness of Allah. So you have to have knowledge of your Lord, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Knowledge about his names, knowledge about his attributes, and the like. And knowledge of his prophet, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the ulama, they said that the meaning of I bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah, and that Muhammad is his messenger, peace be upon him, that the first one is to have knowledge about La ilaha illallah. To have knowledge about La ilaha illallah. To have knowledge about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. As Allah said in Surah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَاعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Know that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. So Allah commanded his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and of course his ummah, to have knowledge about La ilaha illallah. So you have to have knowledge about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then knowledge about his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This necessitates that you study Al-Quran and you study the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so that you will know about your Lord and you will know about your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Shaykh, he said, Shaykh Al-Utaymeen, he said these matters, which the author rahimahullah mentioned, comprise the whole of the deen. Because all of the deen is based upon these matters, because these are called usuluddin, the foundation of the religion. Without them, salat will not benefit a person. Zakat will not benefit him. Fasting the month of Ramadan will not benefit a person. So these matters that the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned, they comprise the whole of the deen. Should be given great attention due to their tremendous benefit. So we have to focus on these four matters. Shaykh said, ma'rifa, knowledge and awareness of Allah, the mighty and majestic, with the heart. Because al-ma'rifa and knowledge has to do with the heart. Because, dear respected brothers and sisters, that al-a'mal, actions, are of two categories. You have inward actions and you have outward actions. Right? Inward actions is actions has to do with your heart. For example, having knowledge about Allah. This has to do with your heart. Believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Loving Allah, fearing Him, putting your trust on Him. All these have to do with your heart. You see? Now, the outward actions, for example, the salat. Because everyone can see it. It's outward, right? Physical action. And also, when you give sadaqah, it's necessitate that you give it with your hand, right? And also, when you give zakat. Also, when you perform al-umrah wal-hajj. So these are outward action. The Sheikh said, with such knowledge and awareness, that it makes the person accept whatever he has prescribed and laid down. So the person, when he has knowledge about his Lord, then this would necessitate that you will accept his commandment, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You will accept his what he prescribed upon you, what he made obligatory upon you. You will submit to his laws, subhanahu wa ta'ala, his sharia, his legislation, and the like. And it causes him to submit to that, and to judge by the prescribed laws which his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. You don't judge yourself by your desires. You judge by what Allah revealed in the Quran and the sunnah of the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The servant increases in knowledge and awareness of his Lord by considering the clear signs pertaining to the deen found in the book of Allah, mighty and majestic, and in the sunnah of his messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And also by considering the signs which Allah has provided for us in the creation. So now there are two signs. That which is in the kitab and sunnah. And these are called al-ayat al-shar'iyya. Al-ayat al-shar'iyya. The legislative signs that are in the kitab are in the sunnah. When you read the Quran, it increases your iman. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the believers in Surah Al-Anfal, He said, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. The believers are only those, when Allah is mentioned, their heart tremble because of the fear of Allah that they have, and the knowledge that is in their heart about their Lord. So their heart trembled. And when his ayat, his verses are recited unto them, it increases them in their iman. These are the true believers. Because the believers, their belief in Allah increases them in their iman. And their knowledge also increases them in their compliance. And in their obedience to their Lord, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sheikh said, Rahimahullah ta'ala, we have only about 5 more minutes because Salat Isha is coming soon. The Sheikh said, Na'am. And considering the signs which Allah has provided for us in the creation, when you look at the sea, the ocean, you look at the mountains, and you reflect upon the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This will increase you in knowledge about your Lord. You know that your Lord is the one who created the mountain, is the one that created the ocean, created man. And other than that, you look at the creatures, look at the bird, you look at the butterflies. So you reflect. طيب؟ نعم. The Sheikh said, Himawallahu ta'ala, so whenever a person examines, considers the signs, he will increase in his knowledge. And awareness of his creator and his God, who alone has the right to all his worship. Allah the Mighty and Majestic says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and on the earth there are signs for those with certain belief. And also in yourselves, will you not then consider? And Allah mentioned this a lot in the Quran. أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبِلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ. Don't they reflect upon how
The camels were created,
right?
وإلى السماء
كيف رفعت.
And don't they reflect upon the sky how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised it up. So we should reflect upon not only the signs that are in the kitab and the sunnah, but in the creation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. So inshallah, we will stop here because the time has caught up with us. And I can take one or two questions because Salat al-Isha is already in.